going to take too much of your time this morning, but last week, I was thinking about New Year's Day being on the first day of the week. And the very first day of the new, a year is what's going to be Sunday. And I got thinking about, what can I bring to the attention of the congregation that would be good? And I wonder how many of you made any New Year's resolutions. Nobody's made any? That's all right. You would have broken them anyway before.
Never been broken.
We've all been broken. But I got thinking about New Year's resolution, and it was Friday morning. Friday morning that it popped in my mind that there's a lot of verses of Scripture, a lot of verses of Scripture, that would make a good resolution for anybody who is a Christian. One of the Scriptures that came to my mind is at the very top of the passage, things that I passed out today. And I'm going to read just the 14th verse of the third chapter of the book of Philippians, where Paul says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. It's interesting to me to note that Paul says he had not attained everything that he wanted to attain. He still had a long way to go before he was able to reach the heights of his spirituality that he wanted to reach. I think that's amazing. If Paul, in all that he did, never reached and attained the what he wanted to do, and he says he continues to press on towards the mark of a high calling of God in Christ Jesus. What about us? Have we reached the heights of our spirituality that we possibly could reach? And I got thinking about that. And this morning, what I would like to do is call forth a panel of experts. And if you notice in this passage, the paper I passed out this morning, there's nine different ones that wrote them, the books of the New Testament. And out of each book, out of each author, I'm going to call forth a verse of Scripture that could be a resolution. And I'm not going to take much of your time. We'll just read these and make a few comments on them. But in Matthew, our first expert would be Matthew. Matthew, what would you recommend as far as a resolution is concerned? He says in Matthew, writes in Matthew 6:33, during the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus was preaching, Jesus said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Priority number one is to seek the kingdom of God. Priority number one is to seek his righteousness. Man, I'll tell you, that is a difficult one. But notice, if we commit our life to Christ, seek the righteousness of God through Jesus Christ, all the things that are necessary in life will be added unto us. The next one, Mark. Let's call forth Mark. Mark 13:33. Take ye heed and watch and pray, for you know not when the time is. And this is when Jesus is talking about this is coming again. And he says that we will not know when the Son of Man will return. What do we do in the meantime? We watch and we pray. Looking at our attendance this morning, I wonder what would happen if Jesus came back today. What would happen? I hope that wasn't the trump of God and we were left behind. But what would happen if we were to come back again? We need to be ready at all times, every minute of the day. Let's call forth Luke. What would Luke say? In Luke 6:46, Jesus says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? I think that is typical of many, many, many people today. Lord, I love you. Lord, Lord. And then they turn around, and when they read the Scriptures, well, that's not for us today. I think we need to realize that the Scriptures are for all time. They're just as relevant today as they were the day that were written. And I know one man, when I was preaching in Titusville, I resigned the church there, and I came down to this area as I preached there. But as I was getting ready to move, a man knocked on my door and came in and says, I hear, I understand you're leaving the church. He said, yeah. He said, I want to be a preacher. And I said, well, what's the education? He says, oh, I can't read, but I want to preach. And when I was talking to him, he said that he received the scriptures and he just wanted from God. He preaches the word of God and didn't know a thing about what the Bible said. Needless to say, I didn't even recommend him to the church. John, I love this one. John 15:12. This is my commandment, that you love one another. And this is the key. Even as I loved you. How many of us are willing to lay down our life for the people of church? How many of us are willing to lay down our life for Christ? When I preached down in Tennessee, there was a young man there by the name of Carlos Fields. He was pretty much of an area evangelist. He preached in several revivals. He held, started several churches. He was working in new churches. But he went to one of the Muslim countries as on a missionary trip. He spent 3 years there. Not 3 weeks there, I'm sorry. And as he was came back and gave a report to the ministers of that area, he told us, he says, they wanted us to come into the big city for protection because it was dangerous for us to stay in the outlying villages where we were preaching. He said, but that would take away from my preaching. He says, we stayed in the villages where the danger was there, where we might even lose our life. He said he was willing to lay down his life for his friends. I love the passage of Paul as far as Romans is concerned. A passage I think we're all familiar with. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and perfect, acceptable and perfect will of God. This passage, to me, for a long time held a great confusion. Because why would we present ourselves a living Christ or a sacrifice? Wasn't Christ our sacrifice? What was being talked about there? And then several years ago, I would imagine about 25, 30 years ago, I began a study of some of the Old Testament passages that talked about the various sacrifices under the Mosaic Law. Christ has fulfilled every sin offering that was required of that. But there were some offerings that were required of the Jewish people that were not related to sin. For instance, this thank offering. Something happened in your life that you wanted to thank God, you went and offered a sacrifice unto God. Something happened in your life that you wanted to have emphasize the relationship that you had with God, the peace offering. And the idea that when a child was born, you went and offered up turtle doves as far as the sacrifice and a dedication of that child to God. And it came to my mind that what Paul was talking about here was not the offering for sin. It's the offering that we give to God as thanksgiving. It's the offering that we give to God in respect to our peace and our dedication and our commitment to God. And to present yourselves a living sacrifice. Hebrews, unknown author. I don't know whether Paul wrote this or not. I think he did. But I'm going to use it anyway. And here we find that not forsaken the assembling of ourselves together as a matter of some is, they exhorting one another and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Not forsaken. Now I realize there's times when we are sick or times that we have to work. But I think that we need to be loyal and committed to God, not forsaken the assembling of ourselves together. I get a big charge out of Ruth. And she's sitting in the back there. I can I'll talk about her. And she's giving me a dirty look right now. And but get a big charge off her. She tells me that one of the things that she does at her work is offer groups, group counseling, in which it is an education, it is a training for the people that are going through counseling. And one of the things that they require is regular attendance. You know, I kind of feel that with the world the way it is, and with television, some of the advertisements and things you see on television, that Christians need to get together more often than what they do. Because the support that we can give each other in our Christian living is far more important than what we realize. I have seen churches that when a brother or sister in Christ has problems, I knew they wouldn't make it. In fact, I know a church that no longer exists because they were always at odds wanting to see one of their brothers or sisters in Christ fall. And that's not good. Peter, let's call Peter. Let's call Peter just for a moment. Casting all your cares upon him, he says, for he cares for you. I like that passage of scripture. I want you to think just for a moment about the idea of casting your cares upon him. When you cast your cares upon God, when you cast your cares upon Jesus, let's realize that we no longer carry them. We turn them over to God. We turn them over to Jesus. And we need to realize that we become free from those cares. James, very strong passage of scripture. There were several James that I wanted to use. But the one I finally chose was, be ye doers of the word and not hearers only. How many of you look in the mirror while you might want to forget what you look like, you can't do it? How many times do you look in the mirror and you walk away and forget what you look like? I know you say, well, I want to, but do you really? Do you really? And that's the illustration that James used. He that does not do the word but hear only is like a person who looks in the mirror and straightly forgets what he sees. Jude, I like. Jude is one of the stronger ones. Jude says, beloved, when I give all diligence to write unto you the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. Two things I want to point out here. We earnestly contend for the faith. That means that we go out and we tell others about God. We tell others and we exhort them to come and to be a part of God's kingdom. And the second thing about this verse of scripture that I wanted, which was once delivered unto the saints. In other words, the Bible, the New Testament, is all we need. We don't need the Book of Mormon. We don't need Charles Russell's writings. We do not need the edicts of the Pope. All we need is God's Word. And for our conclusion, and I'm going to bring this to a close, for our conclusion, John, and I'm going to call upon John again, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, it is of the world. We do not love the world. Paul says in 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, the 13th verse, and now above faith, hope, and love, these three, but the greatest of these is love. And that's just the opposite of what's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. We're going to be singing our song of invitation. Just as I am, one verse only. You get out a little bit early. But let's have resolutions that bring us closer to Jesus, closer to the church, and brings a commitment to our dedication to him who died on Calvary for us. Shall we stand for the same?